So we're heading over to that with THC having the first pick, first ban slot on Curse Hollow.
They're going to go ahead and deny the Falstad. Falstad on a big map like this where the bosses are important. Gust is very pivotal. And Gust or Bust, I think the theme of today is Kael'thas being dumb and they're just not even willing to deal with it.
Yeah.
They're just going to ban it out instantly.
I can't blame them too. THC was playing him and favoring him, first picking him in two of our three matches, or two of the three games in the last match, not getting him only when Cognitive first picked him. But with Kael'thas being gone, THC are going to lock in Greymane, and Gust or Bust are looking at a super early Illidan. Remember, Equinox is on this team. This is a player who loves his melee assassins.
Yeah, they are hovering it. We'll see if they're willing to lock it in here. Greymane, the point, the pickup here for THC, just an all-around good hero.
I wonder if they're
surprised
gonna
we didn't see Thrall, though, in that spot.
I wonder if they're going to do the same, the Greymane Apather, once again. Because Gust or Bust were playing, but likely they had somebody watching the stream to let them know that this was a potential.
Well, I do like the Thrall. Thrall's a little bit more consistent.
Mm-hmm.
ETC, good pickup as well. I mean, Thrall is just, both of these heroes are just great at contesting boss points, which is important. Sunring can win you a boss fight. Mosh Pit can win you a boss fight. So good, two really good pickups here for Gust or Bust. THG with the next two picks. Could see an ETC, Myrdin and an Uther.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, if they don't want to get banned out of either of those really important roles where the isolation seems to be focused from the members of all of these teams, they've really been focusing on grabbing a warrior and then banning a warrior, or grabbing a support and banning a support, as generally it's ETC and Myrdin who are the biggest contention points warrior-wise, and then Uther and Rhaegar in those support roles. And Uther is the grab. We'll see if Myrdin looks like they want to go for more of the burst, lots of damage, as they're checking out Leeming.
Well, they do get the Uther, of course, like you said. Divine Shield, great with Greymane, great with any hero, basically. And a good deny against the ETC.
Mm-hmm.
So we've been seeing a lot of that today. The Mosh Pits into Divine Shields into Cleanses, just to prevent any interrupt on it. THC thinking really hard on this Leeming pick, which we've seen a bit today. Faye bringing out some interesting builds, and there it is. They are locking in. First mid-tier ban for Gust or Bust. Probably going to be denying that Muradino.
That has been something that THC has been pretty consistent on in their drafts, is when they see Kael'thas gone in some capacity, or Li Ming gone, grabbing the other one, really wanting to make sure they have one of those mages in their draft. And we saw that in the last series. Myrdin will be the ban, just like you guessed for Gust or Bust. Do we see a Rhaegar ban here from THC?
More than likely, unless there's a certain hero they're more afraid of. Like you said, you did mention the Abathur pick.
Mm-hmm. They're looking at Tyrande too. I mean, Tyrande ETC is a pair that rotations, they can move around a lot. And that is something that Cognitive tried to do on Cursed Hollow in the last game. And they did find some people with that. And it just, also it helps you pick up bosses easier. You can stop the capping of the tributes a lot easier with her sentinels, so she's a good all-around pick to have, especially with this. But Gust or Bust, now they bring out the Illidan and the Tassadar.
Yeah, and they get Rhaegar. THC would just really cripple themselves. They're like, well, let's deny them the Abathur, right? They would have double support. Gust or Bust could still go Brightwing or Karazim there, and it would be just as good. So Gust or Bust, man, they've got a disgusting comp here. So much damage, so much just aggression coming out from them. THC with their last two picks, I mean, at four a warrior, there's a decent amount on the table. More than likely should be seeing the Joanna, though. And there's that Abathur. We're talking about it
again. You know, I like the ban on Kael'thas too from Gust or Bust if they're really focusing on this melee heavy composition, because it in those choke points when you have everyone funneling in, you can get a lot done with living bombs, the chain bombs, and Master of Flame later on. Abathur does get grabbed by THC. Likely we'll see Prismaticism on Abathur once again, and their warrior
Joanna. Makes sense. And then keep in mind, guys, last game we cast on Cursed Hollow. They did have Abathur. Team Higher Consciousness did. And they had the Greymane, too. And those Greymane clones were making some insane plays, Gilly.
They had Kael'thas, Greymane, Uther, Johanna, Abathur. So everything is literally the exact same as last game, except Li Ming instead of Kael'thas.
You're right. That is true.
That's why I write these things down.
She remembers everything.
I just have it on a piece of paper right by my keyboard.
Last pick here for Gust or Bust. Be really surprised if they went solo support Tassadar. Mm-hmm. Should be seeing that Rhaegar. Brightwing is also a possibility here. But there it is, the Rhaegar being covered. And this is just a disgustingly good composition here from Gust or Bust.
Yeah. THC get what they want. They for sure have what they want, but Gust or Bust do too. Without a doubt.
Both teams got the draft they wanted for sure. Knowing Equinox style, knowing what we've seen from Team Higher Consciousness today, they definitely got the compositions that they wanted.
Still thinking. It is Rhaegar.
Yeah. There was a discussion to definitely be had there of the argument from Brightwing versus Rhaegar. Brightwing giving the global presence helps counteract the Abathur push. But would you get too much value out of Polymorph? I mean, a CC is always good, but it's not highly prioritized here. I think I agree with the Rhaegar pick, though there was an argument for Brightwing for sure, so they were being very patient with that pick.
As they should be. This is it. The winner of this match qualifies for DreamHack Austin. I don't know how much these teams actually know of each other, right? I thought I saw in chat that Prismaticism might have just joined the team for THC, so if that's the case, they're definitely not used to this team completely. Whereas Gust or Bust basically is a team that has been playing all together for a long time, switching out just one member as they picked up Equinox. But here we go, guys. Cursed Hollow, game number one of this best of three. Get hyped. Tell people on Twitter. Use the hashtag DHATX2016 and the hashtag HGC. You can even tag us if you want. These are our Twitter handles. We would love to hear from you. We are super pumped to get into this game.
Guys, again, qualifying match here. Get excited in chat. Get on Twitter. Get on Reddit. Let people know what's going on. And here we go on the left-hand side of the map in the blue trunks. It's going to be Gust or Bust, Equinox on Illidan, and Collusion on ETC, Frozen X on Thrall, Talking Trees on Tassadar, and rounding out the team is Dark Chimera playing Rhaegar.
And our surprise team from the last match, THC in the red, with Buds playing Greymane, Justin on Johanna, Hanwen playing Li Ming, Matra on Uther, and of course, Prismaticism playing Abathur. Following you.
Nice. Well, let's see here how this is going to go for these two teams. Tension's on the line. Is this Gust or Bust's second time almost qualifying? No, they made top 8 last time. They lost to, I believe, Cloud9 in the round of 8, which was a 2-1. Very close set for them. I do not remember how far Team Higher Consciousness got in the last qualifier, though. So both teams, it is definitely both teams' first times making it into the round of 4.
Uh-oh, Frozen X on the chase. Li Ming getting away. But Li Ming versus Thrall by themselves up at the top. Li Ming will have to be very cautious of that matchup. The big push coming from THC will be down in the bottom. We've got Abathur here. Can always help out with the symbiote elsewhere. But with the Locust, it will be here in the bottom. Matra and Buds also trying to do what they can. But the response from the double support, actually, from Gust or Bust there in the bottom.
Yeah, definitely. I like this lane positioning coming out from both these teams. Neither can get too aggressive in the early game without sacrificing lane experience. Playing it pretty smart so far. Hanwen having a trouble here, of course, as Thrall is one of the best laners in the game. Thrall being a very good job of a bully here, so Prismaticism does rotate up to help provide a little bit of extra lane presence and a little bit of extra soaking.
By the way, Lightning Bond, once again, the choice at level 1 for Rhaegar. So every time he uses the Lightning Shield, he'll get one of his own. He can do a lot of extra damage, and when they're throwing that on Equinox, he can be right up there too, and he can look to try to throw out a lot of damage between the two of them too. Also, it will help him to later on if he ends up going for something like the Earth Shields.
Let's see here. Where this first contention will be, how many teams will rotate. Like we saw last game versus Abathur, Faye stayed bottom lane. to try and even out the soaking Abathur does in the early game. You always have to be mindful of the presence of Abathur in the early game. If you get stalled out of the tribute for a long time, which this composition definitely has with the Greymane poke, Leeming poke, Joanna poke, and Uther poke, Abathur can get you very far ahead. So Gusterbus has to be very mindful of how they approach this first tribute.
Absolutely, and speaking of that tribute, it's about to spawn in the bottom lane. Prismaticism already in position to soak up at the top, and Frozen X is leaving. So this is the chance to do just what you said for THC. Safely poke, safely deny capping of this tribute for Gusterbus. But actually, Equinox going back up to the top, so they will be keeping someone up there to limit that that soak for Abathur, and this means Talking Trees is not going to get stopped in time, and that's huge for Gusterbus that they can pick that up. They don't miss out on any of the experience gains, and they pulled a lot of people down here from THC to try to stop that not able to do so.
Yeah, it's a really big mistake coming out here from THC, and we do see Equinox pushing into this top four. With this Bruiser camp, going to be able to do some serious damage. Rotation from Joanna and Lee Ming are headed up, so that will be able to clear it up, but good push so far from Equinox, and yeah, Gusterbus getting a huge advantage off of just getting that for free.
But THC aren't down too far, really close in experience too, and it's only the first tribute. So hopefully for them, they're able to maybe pick up this one as the next one is starting to spawn up toward the top. And Abathur already burrows down to the bottom lane as Greymane will see him start to head up. Tassadar may stay, knowing that Abathur is here. Mantra actually gets caught on that rotation there, so it's a bit longer until they'll have all of the members up. Gusterbus may get in a position for this a little bit faster, and they're starting to go after the fight. Equinox, though, is in trouble, gets hit by the Hammer of Justice, but is going back in, blinded by the shield there, and that's so great. He has to move back away from that perfect grab there for Johanna, being able to blind him for a bit until the team can get into position.
This is closer to how the tribute fight I thought was going to go for the first one. He's doing a good job. Nice power slide, though, catching two members. Houndwind getting low. Mantra might go down, but he is a ghost now, so he can heal the team. Bud secures the kill onto the Illidan there, and they're turning this around. Abathur hat on Bud. Frozen X is going to fall. Collusion getting body block, gets the power slide out of there. He's just barely going to live, but this tribute and two kills for one going over to Team Higher Consciousness.
And it took a little while to do that too, but Prismaticism nearly falling in the bottom lane had to reposition there. Leaving Tassadar meant that, yes, they did keep and make sure that they didn't lose out on the experience soak and even putting some pressure onto these towers, but they did lose the tribute and a couple of heroes. So again, these teams very neck and neck in experience as they're looking toward getting their heroic abilities.
Yeah, we'll see what heroics each team will be taking. I'm not expecting anything too crazy this game. Of course, we saw the ultimate evolution last game with the Greymane clones was doing wonders, so we should be expecting the same here from Team Higher Consciousness. Bruiser camp being taken here by Buds. He's going to be pushing in that middle lane. Equinox doing the Bruiser camp for his own team.
Those will be pushing against each other as the next tribute phase starts pretty soon. Both teams having what looks to be very normal talents grabbed. The one thing I did notice is that Illidan picked up Battered Assault at one instead of the Immolation.
Yes, he did, changing it up a little bit, which is fine. Both are very viable. Most of Illidan's talents throughout his entire kit have a use everywhere. He's got a very well-rounded talent pool, so you can see any talent based on the current the situation here. So not too crazy there coming up from Illidan. Level 10 here for both teams, but Gusterbus having the slight advantage. Abathur's going to have to do a good amount of soaking here. Talking Trees might go down. That's exactly what they needed there. That's going to even up the experience a bit. With Abathur top lane, if he's going to aggressively soak, that's going to get them at very early. It's going to catch them up on level 10, but Gusterbus so very close to 10. Even if they get 10 first, I don't think they can contest just because it's 4 versus 5.
Buds is going in. They know they're about to get their heroic abilities. They push them back just long enough to hopefully secure their own, and they get the next tribute and hear the heroics start coming out. Wave of Force for Lee Ming. Stage dive for ETC.
Yep, stage dive showing the global presence here on the map. It's getting late. It's not getting late. It's just been a long day.
A great push for THC. Get a couple of towers, see Giants help them grab those two, and that helps them eke their way into being ahead in experience. Three members up at the top. Abbott, they're still soaking his happy slug heart away. And Johanna making sure to keep up mid. So both teams doing a really good job of making sure to keep up the pressure in all of the lanes. But a lot more push and damage was done by THC as they start to rotate up at the top.
Loving the wave of force pick up here. I wonder if that was taken, though, thinking that there was going to be mosh.
Yeah.
But still, you can use it to secure kills. You can use it to, reposition here. As a collision, taking a lot of damage, gets bursted down pretty hard. Does get healed up by Dark Chimera, though. Nice condemn coming out from Justin. There's Prismaticism on that Gray main cloak. Equinox going for a Metamorphosis in the backline. Gets shielded up by Tassar. Taking a lot of damage. Nice Divine Shield going down onto Buds, and he's going to secure a kill onto Thrall. Rhaegar's going to go down as well. Tassar getting very low. Talking Chase probably won't survive this. Will the chase happen? Equinox is going to fall. A 3-for-nothing exchange. Prismaticism not going to be able to get that kill onto Talking Trees, but that is going to be a curse here and a big win for THC.
The wave of forces were really good too from Li Ming, especially that last one on Illidan, and it started and it was super back and forth that fight. The Ancestral was great, the Divine Shield was great, but just barely THC were able to start to get the kills down. And once they got one, of course, Li Ming just starts getting power and power, especially with this Calamity build. She was teleporting in right on top of Illidan and the rest of the team, and especially taking out Rhaegar early on, you know. Getting Uther down early on, he still provides the heals. But they're trying to turn this back around. Gust of Bust want to get into a fight, want to take some people down so they don't get as much from this curse, but instead it backfires. They lose not only Illidan, but they lose Thrall. Shrink Ray hits Collusion. He's going to go down too.
This aggression is insane. That's all three forts falling in one curse. 9 minutes into the game. Three kills again. 9 kills to one out of nowhere. They thought they had him because Buds was completely out of mana. Didn't have very high HP pool. Uther showing up the right time was able to keep him alive. And they turned that into 3 kills for nothing. This is such a huge win here for Team Higher Consciousness. They start doing keep damage in both bottom and mid because of the curse. And out of nowhere, almost a full 2-level lead. Almost 3-level lead here for Team Higher Consciousness.
That was nuts how much they got from that curse. And it was just because they were able to win those 2 fights in a row. Such great play from them this entire qualifier. Now they're taking out their boss. They get it. What?
The Abathur mines are everywhere.
Yeah, they're giving vision. They know they're here, but they had to go back and heal up. THC did. So they're just going to eat this boss, especially because they still have all of their forts up. This is a boss that's going to push in on the top all the way to the keep. There's no towers remaining here. That makes Gust or Bust have to go back. And THC can completely play this out how they want, getting the other mercenary camps they want, then maybe leisurely going down to the bottom and clearing up the boss. But there's so much further ahead in this game.
I think I'm getting an update here in Skype. It looks like Blaze ended up losing 2-0 to Gale Force Esports, by the way.
Wow.
So they'll be taking on Cloud9 in our other semifinal match. Another upset here today here, Gilly.
Yeah, and I do believe that is a battle of ex-teammates, as it's Rafflecopter on Gale Force versus the Team Blaze.
Yeah.
So it's pretty big. It's always really nice to be able to say, like, hey guys, I'm doing okay. See, it's all fine here, though I know that they are still friends. But great job to Gale Force. Can't wait to see their play up against Cloud9 in the next match. But for now, THC 16th to the 14th of Gust or Bust, and they are getting super aggressive here, Zoya, going after this forward mercenary camp, this forward bruiser camp, to keep Gust or Bust back in their base.
Yeah, we'll see what Gust or Bust plans to do to claw their way back into this game, but it's not looking good so far, Gilly. Next tribute spawning. Serious siege damage here to the bottom keep wall with the Locust with the push from these three heroes, as well as the Siege Giants. The front wall falls very quickly. Joanna's repositioning herself. Of course, you see the ETC up here. He is stage diving down, though, on top of them, guys. Bud's taking a lot of damage. Good heals from Uther so far. Divine Shield goes out.
Divine Shield is on Greymane, so he can continue on. Collusion gets healed back up, but they still lose Thrall, and Equinox has to use Metamorphosis just to survive, just to get back from the team. They didn't have the 16 there, and this level difference is showing for THC. They bring down Thrall. They have Abathur, who can always go and get the tribute once they finish with that ultimate evolution if they want. Equinox trying to come back in now that they know that the ultimate evolution is done, but he gets hit. Prismaticism, there he is, picking up that tribute. It's the beauty of having him with that global presence. But this is the amount of time where people have started to get whittled down. Greymane is going to go down, and Buster Bust are feeling it. They know that they've finally started to bring down a couple of members of THC, and that's going to give them this comeback experience that they so desperately need.
Oh, Equinox going for the chase here. Joanna actually secured a kill versus ETC with the Abathur hat. And now Equinox is taking a lot of damage to the Abathur hat and the minions here. And Equinox falls too.
Blessed Shield comes out.
Talking Trees. Will they be able to get Talking Trees? No. Oh my gosh. This is that was an interesting change to the fight there. Bottom keeps very low. The Siege Giants that were taken earlier did some serious push and are starting to work on this top four. But the Tribute did end up going over to THC, as Abathur did cap it, like you pointed out, and
he's a terror. He is a menace on Abathur. Oh my god.
All right. Well, let's move on, as two-level lead almost here for Team Higher Consciousness. This is the next Tribute spawning. All five members are up for both teams. It is on Gus or Bust side of the map. They're struggling to find the positioning in this game here. They need to get the engagement they want. They're on an even tier, finally. They're not in a position where they're being sieged against. And they get the first... They get the head start positioning over here, so they get the better ground. And actually, a delay coming out here. Hao Nguyen goes over the wall for Orb. Equinox is going to go ahead and get on top of Hao Nguyen. And Dark Chimera is going for the cap. Does Justin have the blind up to interrupt this? He does. Get the Blessed Shield off at the last second, stunning Dark Chimera.
Nice, and they're going in. Rhaegar already is down before Collusion can even stage dive in. And now without Rhaegar, this has got to be a full retreat. But THC do not want to let this happen. They go after Frozen X, has to use the Sundering, but they get right back on him. The Greymane Gilnane Cocktail nearly secures the kill. Prismaticism is not done with him yet. He's got the clone. He's gonna at least do what he can to the keep until the clone expires. But this is really big. They get yet another really great kill, and they pick up the Giants too. This is an open keep that they can help these Giants siege down.
Well, this keeps being sieged. Gust or Bust are pushed against their limits right now. They're struggling to hold on to both of these structures here. But they're doing an okay job of it so far. They haven't taken too much damage. Top's still going to stand. Equinox is soaking a lot of damage here to try and make sure that it doesn't get in range of the keep. And he might actually fall in the minions! Oh my god, Equinox, what were you thinking?
I don't know. That's 35 seconds without Illidan! THC are nearly level 20. They're going after their boss, the next boss after that, potentially too. Buster Bust are setting up at the bottom boss. Can they take this out in time though? And this tribute will be a curse.
They have to defend the boss. They have to defend the curse. This could actually just be a checkmate moment for THC.
Yeah.
They've got a boss pushing a top keep that's already half HP. That's probably going down. They got Abathur pushing this bottom keep, which is also probably going to go down very soon. And I like this decision. Just they know that Gust or Bust is going to be defending on multiple fronts. They get a free boss here. They could probably have Abathur burrow up
totally
off the cap
could.
That as well. This is a checkmate play, and they're going to get 20 out of it.
I cannot. Prismaticism is blowing my mind, dude. I simply cannot. There is the boss, the top boss, sieging down the top keep. This one they're gonna go with, as it's easily, they don't even need the boss to take out the keep. They want it to push onto the core, and immediately everyone starts to move around from Gust or Bust. But this is such a difficult moment for them. They do not have level 20, but they know they have to take the fight right now. They can't let all of the members, as well as the boss, get onto that core. So Equinox comes in with the Metamorphosis. Collusion is right behind him. They're trying to make it happen, but Prismaticism has shown up with the Greymane clone, and Dark Chimera is starting to be brought down. He cannot Ancestral himself. He has to stay alive to keep the heals going for his teammates. They have done it. They at least got rid of the clone, but the boss is on core.
Oh, Frozen X being caught opposition. Ancestral not going to connect there. Boss is on core. Like you said, the shield is falling very quickly. Equinox getting stunned out. It doesn't look like it matters, though. They're going for the core. THC going for the throat here, trying to get the kill. Will they be able to end this game? And it's falling so fast. And yeah, that's going to be GG. Game number one in a destructive fashion goes over to Team Higher Consciousness.
I would like to point out that Collusion stage dove at the end and at least got that darn Abathur.
Red team is
I'm like, man, ban Greymane versus, or not Greymane, Greymane maybe, or Abathur, something versus this team on Cursed Hollow, because they just executed the same strategy. And that was even more dominant. probably, than the first game. Yeah, the first game they struggled in the early game. Well, that is...
Chat's reaction to the Locust death from Illidan is...
That's gotta be so frustrating as a player, too. But man, Prismaticism is like, he is just watching like a hawk for someone to go and try to clear those out. And Insta symbiotes and throws everything on them. Some good plays, and that will be game number one between these two teams.
Yeah, really well done from these guys.
Are you loving it, chat?
We're going to throw a quick commercial break. When we get back, we'll have game number two of Gus or Bust versus Team Higher Consciousness. Stay tuned.
Welcome back to game number two. I gotta fix that in the overlay. Between Gust or Bust and THC. With THC one game away from qualifying for DreamHack Austin. How crazy would that be? They've already had such a crazy upset. You're muted.
Also have to keep in mind that this is a new team, I think. Mm-hmm. This was the team that was playing with Sray, right? I know Matre was on the same team.
Pool Plato was...
Well, Matre, it's a different roster in the sense that Matre was on PPST, mm-hmm. So now he's playing with these guys. So it's a new roster that literally happened today. As Sray left... At least Matre's team left... Sray left Matre's team yesterday. So I don't know exactly where people moved around on, but as of today, this roster is new. And here they are, one game from qualifying. Gilly, the draft has started, guys. Here we go. Gust or Bust with the first pick, first ban on Infernal Shrines. And they're going to go ahead and deny the Thrall. Kel'Thas going to be denied by THC. Gust or Bust, like, you know what? You're just too good with Greymane. We're going to deny it.
Yeah, I really like this.
But they gave THC Zul. Zul's really good on this map.
But do they grab it? Have we seen THC play Zul? I don't think so. We have not. They're really focused on Kael'thas. We've seen them play Muradin. Well, we have seen them play Muradin, but Sonya was who I was trying to say. Also focused. They may grab Li Ming here. Okay, so they do get Zul, and with the Kael'thas ban, I was pretty sure they're going to go for Li Ming, as this has been a pretty constant thing for them. So that'll be their two picks. And these two can really, like, Zul can really enable Li Ming to activate her trait and start to get those resets. Gustrobust looking at Uther. Potentially their warrior here. Yeah, I love that. I'm looking at ETC, and then they can ban either a support or a warrior, depending on what they want to cut away from THC more.
Yeah, they're able to deny both. So whichever one they wanted, they feel like is a bigger threat versus their composition. We'll have to see.
This is Muradin
pairs
because...
well with Zul, so you could make up that. But of course, Rhaegar's just such a great healer.
We actually have yet to see THC not play Uther. So this is a pretty pivotal hero, I think, for them. Being able to steal that away will be good for Gustrobust, and we'll see what THC's support player will be on. Definitely not Uther, but potentially also not Rhaegar. Interesting. Respect for the Kerrigan. And Equinox has been a longtime fan of playing Kerrigan.
Yes. Equinox was actually known for, like, only his Kerrigan play when he first hit the scene. He just, like, played him every single game to the point that it was just like, okay, ban Kerrigan versus, you know, Murloc Geniuses. Eventually, though, he did widen his hero pool. Now he's a fantastic melee assassin and a really good shot caller.
Mm-hmm. Do you know if he shot calls for Gustrobust?
I would assume so, because Gustrobust did not have a shot caller beforehand.
Oh, okay.
As far as I'm aware, and now they do. So, unless Equinox just decided to stop shot calling. So I'm assuming he's their shot caller now.
Well, they are banning Taronda, and now THC have two picks. Let's see. They've played Muradin. ETC... trying to see if we've... I thought we saw a Johanna game from them. Yeah, they've played Johanna too, so they have options for who they want. Also, Rhaegar still available. I'm interested to see what THC wants to support with without being able to do Uther.
Okay, so I'm getting an update in chat.
Okay.
Prisma and Matre both are new to the team. I'm assuming both of them were on PPST with Srei. And once Srei left, that kind of caused the team to collapse. And both Matre and Prisma are playing with this team today. And again, for a team that has not played together at all, this is an impressive result. I really have to kind of emphasize that guy. But here we go, Muradin Sylvanas being picked up. We've seen the power of Sylvanas. Ah, this comp is so good from THC. You got the wave clear from Zul. I mean, this is one of his best maps, the rotations, the amount of pressure you can apply before the Immortals mix or Punishers mix. The Punishers deal more. And then, of course, you have the amplified effect with Sylvanas being able to take out the structures. Wow.
Do you remember?
This draft is so good.
Do you remember their Battlefield of Eternity game, the first game versus Cog? They did something similar with the Sylvanas and the Taronda. They are really good at drafting to the battlegrounds, and that's awesome to see from them.
Absolutely. They have a good map understanding. And
especially,
I'm
blown away that this team just comes together and immediately is able to like form compositions that work so well for the battleground and for their team synergy. I'm impressed. So impressed by them.
This is really, really well done draft. Gustrobust, their draft is pretty good as well. I mean, Sonya, Greymane, Uther, great picks, ETC. The only hero I have a problem with here is Zagara. This is essentially a poke comp from THC. Zul only goes in whenever the kill is secured, basically, with the CC. He'll poke with his Q, his Scythe for the most part, so Sylvanas, Li Ming both range. So it'll be hard for THG to find them clumped up enough to land a Money Maw.
Maybe they're going to unite his network.
Okay.
I've got a Kappa face, if you can only see.
I can't see, because... your webcam's not shared with me, but yeah, I mean, I have to give this comp to THG. Again, I mean, I've been talking about Zul a lot. He's first pick worthy on those three maps, Blackhearts, Infernal Shrines, and Tomb of the Spider Queen. Gus or Bus let Zul through. They got the Li Ming, which, as we saw from their previous play, they're great with it. Sylvanas is great on this map, both this map and Battlefield of Eternity. Murden and Rhaegar, great picks. I mean, this comp from THG is great. Guys, we're going into game number two right now. It is loading. Who will come out on top? This is match point for Team Higher Consciousness. If they win this game, they qualify for DreamHack, which I have not seen. Out of all the lands we've been to, Gilly, I have never seen one of these players there. This would be a huge win for these guys.
Absolutely. And especially because they just all got together. They're like, I guess this team works pretty well, I guess.
Yeah.
But yeah, we are going into game number two, match point for them on Infernal Shrines. We haven't seen them play on this battleground yet, so it might be a point where they finally can be, maybe Gusterbus is able to find a place where they aren't as comfortable, but we haven't really seen that yet. Yes, they lost the Sky Temple game, but super strong on Curse and then Battlefield of Eternity, and they've got a great draft to do it. We are ready for the game.
Yep, guys, this is an important match for both of these teams. Gusterbus can't lose this, and well, THC desperately wants to win it. Let's go ahead and introduce our teams here on the left-hand side of the map in the blue trunks. It's going to be Gusterbus, as we do have a pause coming out from Heil Nguyen. Equinox going to be playing Greymane, Collusion playing ETC, Frozen X on Zagara, Talking Trees on Sonya, and Dark Chimera rounding out the team on Uther.
And playing for Team Higher Consciousness in the red, we have Matra on Rhaegar, Justin playing Muradin, Prismaticism playing Li Ming, Buds on Sylvanas, and Heil Nguyen on the Zul.
Well,
I'm going to go back to cams.
Sure. Hello.
Hi, friends. So don't forget, guys, this is the first of our two semifinals we'll be featuring on this stream. Both of these are qualifying matches. The victor secures a spot at DreamHack All-Stars Austin in early May. But we have another qualifier tomorrow, and that's where four teams will be able to grab their qualification spots. It's the final one, as we will then have our eight teams at DreamHack Austin. And I'm so pumped because it's in my hometown, Zoya.
Yeah, that's pretty awesome, Gilly. I'm excited to get to go to this event, as Tempest Storm has qualified, as well as Niventic. These will be the next two teams joining them. So, pretty exciting stuff, guys. Make sure you follow this channel because we will be casting more of this qualifier tomorrow. And it looks like our teams are ready. Countdown has begun, and here we go, guys. Match is underway.
All right, I am joining you. And here we go. Gates will be opening soon. Looking at the talents, very standard stuff, except Li Ming has Force Armor.
Which I like.
That will help, yeah, that'll help a lot with those Gilnean cocktails, especially.
Yeah, definitely. I'll have to see how they're going to play out this early game. Of course, all five members from each team are going to contest middle, but where will the lanes be? Probably going to be sending Zagara top. As for who will be laning against her, I would say Zul probably. Zul will probably be in top lane versus her, and then the rotation will be the other four members of each team.
Yeah, both teams having all of their members in the mid. Zagara going up to place a creep tumor and then coming back down so that they could start that. All of those central areas, like there's one on Dragonshire too, having a creep tumor in those is really important because it provides good vision for any rotations from your opponent's team. And that's one of the big benefits of having a Zagara on your team. Now as this minion wave gets cleared out for THC, we can see that it's going to be Li Ming going top. So yet again, we have Li Ming as the solo lane hero. The rest of them, that's going to be a very big push between Zul and Sylvanas.
Yeah, it's going to do a lot of pressure here. So yeah, like I said, Li Ming up there. It's going to be a struggle for her to win that lane, but Equinox taking a lot of damage here, and he gets taken out. Talking Tree's getting low as well. Do they have enough damage to secure the kill? Nice heal from Dark Chimera to keep him alive, and they're going to get that first blood and rotate to mid.
Yep, they're going back to mid. They always have the potential to send someone up to help Li Ming out too with Zagara, should they need it. But I like that they are just keeping moving back and forth between this. If they can start to really control this mid to bot rotation, then they're going to drain the ammo a lot of towers and can work to try to take them out. Getting those towers down is always a really nice win. But they might have overextended here. How getting some damage on him. But yeah, if you could take the towers down, then you no longer have that safe place to bait a Punisher over away from your opponent so that you can take it out if you lose the shrines.
Prismatism really struggling up here with this, but holding on. Good rotations coming out from these guys. And yeah, Hao Nguyen probably going to just rotate from mid to bottom. Let this kind of be contested by the rest of his team. Apply that pressure. But now he's in trouble and gets collapsed on real hard. That's going to be another kill. Our first kill for Guster Bust this game. Evening up the kill counts 1-1.
Yeah, that's such a great pick for Guster Bust to get to because that alleviates the potential for Zul to get that split soak going back and forth while they contest the shrine. And that's going to be some time until you can get back into those lanes. It sends Li Ming down to the bottom and allows Guster Bust to get started on being able to summon out this frozen Punisher. The bruisers up top were collected by THC, and you notice they're pushing with both Sylvanas and Rhaegar there, maybe foregoing this first shrine just to try to take out as many structures as possible.
Well, we'll see here who's going to come out on top. Right now, Guster Bust at 21-3 in a very significant lead. Matre and Buds pushing in this top lane with this bruiser camp, starting to do some serious damage, but Equinox and Frozen X starting to clear it up. And most of this, like you said, going over to Guster Bust, 26-9 right now. Zul getting some serious push down here, keeping his team even on experience. Will he be willing to contest this now, though? Only 8 more minions needed here for Guster Bust, and now Equinox is here. And they got really good clear with this composition. I don't think, unless they fight, they'll be able to deny this. And yeah, this will be going over to Guster Bust. First Punisher of the game, Frozen, pushing down this middle lane. And it shouldn't get too much value here. All it's got to do is leap over the wall and be cleared up pretty easily. Shouldn't get more than a wall with this push.
I thought Guster Bust did a great job dealing with a lot of issues at once, taking out the Zul, still dealing with top, but making sure that they got back into position in time to, getting into position first at the shrine so that they could get that good lead there. And the kill on Zul also helping them get level 4 just slightly better. They dealt with a lot of craziness everywhere and came out on top by getting that first Punisher.
Yeah, it's really well done from them. Let's talk about the Sylvanas build, that level 4 talent. Just constant spreading of the damage. It's not just great for sieging, which, you know, of course, when you use your W, it spreads to any enemy structure, minion, or hero nearby until it just runs out of things to spread to. So it just kind of disables every structure, and then you can do it constantly. It's not just good siege damage, but it's good hero damage. You'll constantly see Sylvanas as several, thousand damage ahead of the next highest damage of played rep. But here's the ready coming up from Equinox. We should be getting that countdown soon.
Also, Hurricane instead of focus attack for Sonya. Casting Rowan removes all slows and roots.
Well, level 7 almost here for Guster Bust.
I like that too. The potential to be hit by Zul's roots is always a little bit of a scary thing. And then there's slows too from the Earthbind Totem. They're gonna actually lose Muradin, by the way, and that's giving level 7 to Guster Bust.
Yeah, level 7 here, first hit from them, showing some really good aggression here. That's gonna give them some pretty important talents. Cleanse gonna help out a lot, like you said, Zul and Muradin. Very difficult to deal with.
Mm-hmm.
A little bit more survivability as well from Sonya at this tier. Battle Momentum on Zagara for more sustain DPS as well. So, very important tier for this team. But THC not too far behind.
They grab their level 7-2, and it will still be Calamity for Prismaticism, even though they have both the Charged Blast and the Force Armor. But I think really just trying to get what they can to try to help with those shrine battles. The Charged Blast will help with that, as will the Calamity too.
Well, let's keep an eye on what the next contention is. Despite having this heavy push composition with Sylvanas and Zul, Guster Bust is doing a good job of denying all of it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Sylvanas isn't really pushing hard. Zul's not pushing hard. The rotations and, you know, the constant presence of Sonya and Uther in these lanes is really helping a lot. And the lack of a solo laner is also hurting a lot as well. Look how low Prismaticism's getting. The front wall's starting to go down, and Prismaticism tries to contest this much more than he already is. Equinox is sitting right here to go for a gank.
Yeah, it's really important for Guster Bust that they've been able to get the lead on the rotations. because of the one kill they got on Zul, winning the Punisher, it enabled them to get a huge mercenary push in every single lane. Now, Greymane and Zagar are on the fort up top. It's prompting Justin to come up, but it's pretty low in health. Li Ming only there to try to defend. It has been very difficult for them. And with that, Gust and Bust are on the cusp of getting their heroic abilities.
Yeah, very, very close to that. We'll see what heroes we're going to be. I mean, we've seen some stage dive action today from Gust or Bust, but it will be the Mosh Pit this time around. Everything looking that normal. Should not be seeing a Nidus form, but keep in mind, Equinox is a former teammate of Faye, so you never know what crazy ideas have sunk into his head.
It'll be Devouring Maw, so super standard across the board for them. No Oz today, which makes me sad.
Had to squeeze it in.
I'll keep dreaming on. I promised the chat that I would do it.
Well, she delivered, chat. Level 10 almost here for THC. Wave of 4 is going to be picked up again. We saw them pick it up last game for the counter to the Mosh Pit. This time there is a Mosh Pit. Avatar, Ancestral Healing, Poison Nova, and Wailing Arrow, the heroics here. And then another Punisher going on over to Gust or Bust.
See how much they actually can get done with it. There's still one tower ahead of it, and they are in position to try to bait it over that wall. And here comes the jump. The Mortar Punisher.
It's going to die very quickly.
Yeah.
They shouldn't get more than the front wall here. Collusion going for a flank, though. They're clumped up. Dwarf Toss already out of here. Houndwind in a lot of trouble. They don't have their support Rhaegar with them, so if he does get stunned, there's no cleanse to save him. But the power slide misses. Doesn't seem to matter, though. Houndwind going to fall.
Wailing Arrow tried to come back up to help, but it was not enough to save Zul. And with that, where it looked like it was just going to be a wall, now it's suddenly a lot more as the first port of the game will fall. And they're continuing the fight. Divine Shield hits ETC to help him stay in the fight, and they bring down Rhaegar as well.
Really, really well done here from Gust or Bust. They're secured just some 4 kills so far this game. Devouring Maw, and I don't know if they can follow up on this. Do they have the damage? Nice body block coming from the Avatar there. It's going to be a really big mosh pit, though, that's going to secure that kill as well. Buzz was trying to do as much damage as he could over the wall. Justin's going to die for trying to save his teammate. Collusion probably won't go down, and yeah, he'll just barely save there. And again, 2 more kills going over to Gust or Bust, 6 kills to 1. They've got some map presence as top has taken some serious damage due to that Zagara solo lane up there. Bottom's gone down, so Gust or Bust, you know, really in a significant lead right now.
Yeah, I love Collusion being able to spot out the fact that he could get both Muradin and Li Ming in the mosh pit, because those are two of they're the important ones, the ones who can interrupt it with Wave of Force and then the Storm Bolt. To be able to get both of those in meant that they are both going to go down. Sylvanas nearly took out Collusion, but wasn't there in time. Justin, recognizing that Gust or Bust are stealing away these siege minions, and they're trying to get aggressive. They're trying to find a place to get into a fight, make a pick before their opponents get 13, but Gust or Bust just completely moving back, waiting until they get that point before they are ready to get into a fight, making sure they have everyone up and they have that advantage for the next shrine phase.
And the more this game develops, the more I like this draft. I mean, they've won the early game significantly because of the rotations and because of the Zagara. And now as they're getting closer to late game, Greymane gets a really big power spike at 13 and 16. Sonya considered a real hero and a monster of a hero at level 16. Very difficult to deal with. So the longer this game goes, the more powerful this composition is for Gust or Bust. Sonya just going to do so much more damage. Greymane doing so much more damage. And because THG is behind now, they're going to have difficulty getting back into this game. They're going to have to catch people out of position.
They're at least using the fact that they have Sylvanas to their advantage and bringing down some structures to get some experience. But Gust or Bust have already set up at the shrine, and Zagara is once again sieging at the top. She's going to start to move back up to the shrine, hopefully, as the rest of the members of THC are here to try to catch her. And in fact, Frozen X has to throw out the Devouring Modesty, save Justin. Dwarf passes in and takes out Zagara, and now the fight rages on. They're going to be able to push back Gust or Bust for now and look to try to grab, finally, their own Punisher in this game.
Yeah, this is exactly what they needed. They needed a pick, and that's what they got. 17 seconds until Zagara's back up, but they're not really contesting this point too heavily. They need to get in a more aggressive position to deny Equinox and the ability to steal minion hits, as they're still in the advantage, 21-9. Storbolt connects with Equinox, not enough damage there. There's the root coming out from Zul. They are forcing them back, but right now, with this 5v4, THG has not gotten too much of an advantage out of this.
And Zagara is back, too. She's headed back up here, and only 17 as They're trying to at least catch up in the minions. They're going to have to try to get another fight. At least Devouring Maw is down for Gustrobust. That's a nice thing. All of the heroic abilities still available for THC as we hear Wrath of the Berserker start. Wailing Arrow goes out to the Divine Shield, hits Greymane, and Equinox is ready to get back into this fight.
Really, really poor heroics coming out from THC. Now Hollow doing an awkward spot. Does get cleansed, trying to reposition himself. Kiting back, still a big advantage here for Gustrobust. Minion counts in favor of THC, but just for a moment. Suddenly it's even 36 to 34. Now THC trying to get onto the point. They need six minions. Gustrobust needs one. And this goes over to Gustrobust. And now they're fighting underneath this Punisher. It's going to immediately stun some of these heroes. They got to try and kite back or get out here, but they're looking for the fight. There's the mosh pit on two heroes. The collusion gets taken out very quickly for Rhaegar.
Yeah, but Rhaegar and Li Ming are down on the side of THC. They take out Zul too, and now Justin is caught between a bunch of members of Gustrobust. We're chasing him away from the Punisher, and he's even being chased down by a Mutalisk here. He's healing himself back up as best as he can with his trait, but for now he is just going to have to delay for as long as he can, as Talking Trees is still running away. And this should be the end. Meanwhile, in top lane, there's a Punisher that is sieging in the top. It's been baited over the towers, but they're just now starting to get everyone up. And with this long delay, Muradin going down, it's going to be 30 more seconds.
A merry chase, indeed.
Yeah, until THC has everybody even back up. The merry chase. I don't know if it felt that merry for Sonya.
It was merry for me, though. I was enjoying watching that, that's for sure. Last fort of THC going to go down here. A two-level lead here for Gustrobust, having their 16 pounds. And just such a significant position right now. They've got the top keep exposed, which they can push in later if they want to either get a free keep or go for a core. They do have that avenue open for them. Still a full level until THC's on even tier, so they're struggling to get themselves back into this game, but it's definitely not over for them. The main issue right now with THC is their last two team fights, as Equinox does DC here. But the last two team fights are just, the ultimates have been pretty sloppy. I mean, the Wailing Arrow only hit one person that last fight. The Avatar gets popped early every time. And the Wave of Force not really getting the best value here.
Yeah, they used the Poison Nova, but it was pretty late into the fight. They really were trying to bring them down, but I think they had already maybe even lost. I think maybe Rhaegar they lost at that point already, and you're right, they're just not finding the synergy that they had found in earlier games, being able to make sure they are getting a lot out of their heroic abilities. Wailing Arrows, did you mention that one? Not really.
Yes,
getting
they
a,
did
okay.
not get it. Only hit the ETC in this last fight.
Mm-hmm. Well, we'll see if they can turn it around. They are at a disadvantage, but they haven't lost a keep yet. So there is still time. By the way, Sylvanas picked up Will of the Forsaken, which used to be a level 16 talent, but has been moved to level 13 with her rework. Allows her to become unstoppable and get movement speed. Struggle is real.
Yeah. Remember when we were like, hey, it'd be okay to cast Gold League at 3 a.m. and then do an NA qualifier at 10 a.m.? We're silly people.
Yay. I know, I'm passing out as soon as...
Oh, yeah. KO was messaging me earlier, hey, you want to order food when we're done? No. I'm immediately going to bed. Sorry, bro. He's like, oh.
You're not
going to
eat?
Damn. No, I am not eating. I am just going to go collapse in that bed as soon as possible. But I'm excited for tomorrow as well. I'll actually, waking up right before Gold League tomorrow will be a good thing, so tomorrow will be much easier. And I can just kind of maintain that sleep schedule for the rest of the month because we'll be casting Gold League for that long.
I know, it's crazy. It's so much longer than the last Gold League. I was not expecting that.
It was like a little less than 2 weeks. I think it was a week and a half.
It was a little bit longer. It was like 2 weeks, I think.
I don't think so. I think Cloud9 was only there for a week and a half. Their first trip, they were there much longer, but the second trip was very, very short.
Yeah, but they came back after group stage, didn't they?
True, but it didn't wait. Maybe it was like a little over a week and a half then.
I think it was about 2 weeks.
About 2 weeks, maybe. This one's a lot longer.
Yeah, 4 days a week for a month is pretty crazy, but as long as we keep seeing some Sergeant Hammer picks, I am okay with that.
If you say so.
It didn't work out.
No.
It did not.
Take a look at the hero damage. Again, like I keep talking about the Sylvanas. You have to take it with a grain of salt, though. Yes, 37,000 damage for Buds versus the 29,000 of Li Ming, who's in second. But a lot of it is AoE spread damage that can, in a sense, sometimes be inconsequential. It's very similar to old multi-shot Vala, where she'd be really high in the numbers, but she wasn't able to secure kills because it's all spread damage. Same with Nazebo. Really good numbers. Yes, Lunara as well. So it's still a very good hero. You get the pushing power, and her damage is much better than before. But, you know, when you see these numbers, do keep in mind that it is a spread that constantly happens that does a little bit of damage to everyone. So, yes, she's ahead. And it is good damage, but it is inflated a bit just because it's spread out so much.
Zagara, on the other side, is beating Greymane, but now that he has 16... that is likely to change. Although she does get Brood Expansion, which is a really good power spike for her. Once you get Concentrated Blast, it's pretty scary. That ability to burst someone down for Greymane goes way up.
Taking a look at other talents at 16, I'm not seeing anything too crazy. I mean, Benediction is usually the go-to. Sometimes you'll see Hardened Focus, but...
yeah, it just kind of depends if you need, like, that burst heal versus just the more heals more often. You'll see, as well as the fact that, you know, if you can find usage for the Double Stun, which we have. Speed Metal, I like that pick. For ETC, I always get really excited to see that one, and it makes a lot of sense when they have a team who's trying to just get on top of their opponents quickly. He can help out Sonya to be able to do that. Like I mentioned, Concentrated Blast and Brood Expansion. Boundless Conviction from Uther is not something we see a ton on Uther at level 4, but it is something that comes up occasionally. And because you can increase the length and the width of Holy Radiance by 40%, especially the length, allows him to be a little bit safer while trying to heal those frontline heroes for his team. Apparently, Equinox is back in comms, so we're almost there, guys.
Almost there.
So our next match after
I was talking to the admins, wasn't ignoring you.
No, it's fine. Our next match will be between Cloud9 and Gale Force Esports. Right?
Okay. Yes, ma'am. Yes, indeed. We'll see. Apparently he DC'd again.
Well, guys, we will keep you updated as we receive information about what's going on here. Equinox's internet. Didn't you say that he has not the most fun internet in the world?
I mean, you've been casting heroes for a long time. I think he's consistently had issues, unfortunately. Nothing he can do about it.
Yeah.
As he just lives in an area with really bad internet.
Oh, is that? Yeah.
I assume that's the case. I feel bad for him, because this does happen a lot to him, unfortunately.
Agreed. And it upsets the momentum, too, for a team, when you have to pause like this. Especially when they're in the lead. They want to keep the stress, the feeling of stress on THC about this game. The fact that they have all of their forts up, THC doesn't have any of them left, they're down to their keeps. That feeling of momentum that you have this constant aggression going, and then you don't want to really let your opponents take a breath, take a deep breath and say like, okay, it's fine, all we have to do is this. And so having to pause, having to give your opponents that is definitely a frustration for Gust or Bust. But the great feeling is that they know that they're up in this game. It's definitely their game to lose at this point. So hopefully they can get Equinox back in here, finish this out, and then take it to game number 3.
Yeah, they do have a pretty significant advantage right now. Mm-hmm. 10 kills to 3. Map structure, they're way ahead, as all 3/4 of them are owned still.
Do we need to take a break while we get...
I'm just trying to figure out things with the admins and stuff. We should just go to a break until Equinox is back.
All right, we're going to take a break, guys. We'll be in chat to let you know what's going on. Stick with us. We'll be back soon with game number 2 between these two teams.
Yep. Equinox made it back just in time. They had just run out of time. They're about to have to continue without a bot, but because the 10 minutes has been... Oh. Well, we have another pause. I was told that after 10 minutes, no more pauses. Trying to communicate with admins and the players right now. So, we're back for a second. Hello! But
oh, I didn't even unmute my mic. The game started.
Nice.
So
Kelly's not even unmuted. She's just been talking by herself. I've been talking by myself. People must be confused. Hello.
I'm sorry, guys. I'm sorry. It's been a long day, but we're hanging in there. We are going to make it. We have another semifinal after this one, but we are having some difficulties with this one. What are you doing there? You're muted. Do you want me to go to break so you can talk to admins?
No, there's just like an annoying fly in my room. I was clapping at it.
Oh, I just saw you clap. I was like, were you celebrating something or? All right, guys. While we're waiting, this is very important. This is super important. Zoya and I have been casting since 3 a.m. Pacific time. We did take like a 2-hour break. I took a nap. He did not. This guy's a trooper. So what we could really use from you are tweets of adorable animals.
That would not help me at all. Like that might just tilt me.
Puppies and kittens. Why would that tilt you? That sounds amazing. That would give me strength. What do you want instead? Do you want like tweets of Zoya my boya? Like hashtag Zoya my boya? I think that sounds like even a better idea.
Of milk. Whole milk. Not that 2%.
Okay, you
not
can
that
see
low fat,
this guy
not
pictures
that skim.
Of milk. You could see
whole milk,
some pictures of cute baby
preferably
animals.
In gallon form.
Oh, you don't want pictures of milk, you just want actual milk.
Milk works too, but pictures work as well. Just send me milk. Milk's my ultimate life force.
I want pizza. That's what I want. Guys, we're going to make it through this together. Zoya's talking to admins. You guys are tweeting pictures of baby animals. And milk, potentially. I'm watching the game to see if they randomly unpause. Equinox has lost his connection again. It looks like we are potentially going to be unpausing. They may be playing with a bot. Okay, here we go.
All right. Admins ruling. They're following the rules, guys. Let's move on here as they are being forced to... we've already gone a full 5 minutes over the time that they were given. Unfortunately, Equinox hasn't connected. Hopefully, he'll be back in soon. Let's just go ahead into casting the game here. Level 17 versus level 16. 10 versus 3. We'll have to keep an eye on. Are you still following me? I think
I am
are.
Following you, yeah.
Okay, cool. I'll fix the movement speed here. Level 16 here, finally picked up by THC. Gonna go ahead and start working on the bruiser camps here, and Matra does rotate over as well. The next Punisher will be spawning here in the bottom center as well.
Alright, so what Gust or Bust can do, if they think that Equinox is coming back in, they still have plenty of a buffer for their teams. They can just do what they can, take the safe things as much as they can, safe mercenary camps, give up one of these Punishers. They really feel like he is going to be back in soon. Hopefully that will be the case. That looks like what they're doing. This will be a Punisher that goes onto a weakened fort, but still at the very least it buys them some time. The fact that they have been in such a commanding lead structurally that they can take a bit of a breather here until they can get him back.
Yeah, they're doing a good job of contesting this. I mean, like you said, they just kind of have to rotate around right now. They're going to be taking out the bruiser camp here in the top left. They're going to need to clear out this one as it's starting to do damage to the fort. And THC rotating down. Going to be taking out this Punisher very, very quickly as they're at 30. And this is going to be pushing straight into a Keith Gilly. And they have a Sylvanas. This could do some serious damage.
Yeah, it really could. And in short work, they pick up a Frozen Punisher. And it looks like THC are just going to counter pressure the Keep Top. Gust or Bust.
I like this. This is the best.
I love
position.
This too. I love this too. I think this is a great.
This is going to be a base race, Gilly. They're probably going to go core, and I think this is the best option they have given the situation they're
Absolutely.
In. Absolutely. They're going to win this race too. If Greyman actually does any DPS, it's actually a full-on base race. The core is being pushed here by Gust or Bust. They don't have minions with them. The Keep's just about to go down. Who's going to win the race, Gilly?
Oh my gosh! Okay, here we go. The shield's already being burned through by Gust or Bust. THC just now starting to do that. They're at 46%.
Oh my god, it's gonna be so close.
Holy cow, who is gonna win this? Oh,
it's gonna be THC. Wow.
Oh, Greymane was back on minions.
Red team is victorious.
Oh, Greymane went to minions. That is just... That is just too unfortunate.
My hands were on my head for that.
Mine too. Well,
that decision was a great
It was
one.
The best decision they could have made, yeah. Given the situation. It's just one of those situations, guys. It's unfortunate, but congratulations to THC White. Let's focus on the positive. They do qualify here for regionals. Unfortunately, Gust or Bust is eliminated here, 0-2. So they'll be competing in tomorrow's qualifier, where I'm sure they'll do well, as long as Equinox Internet holds up.
Yeah, that is pretty unfortunate. They had a huge lead for that game. I applaud that decision at the end. They did exactly what they felt they had to, but the Sylvanas really made a huge difference there. The fact that she could help take out the Keep even faster, keep everything alive as much as possible on her team. But, man, that...
It's an unfortunate situation, mm-hmm. but I mean, this has happened in the past, yeah. and you know, the rules are there for a reason.
Right.
They gave them an extended amount of time, and unfortunately, even after that, there was still no reconnect. So
that will be THC qualifying, though. They qualify.
Yeah, congratulations to them
for DreamHack All-Stars in Austin, and we are not done. We're gonna have another qualification match. It will be between Cloud9 and Gale Force Esports. I know you guys are super pumped in the chat for that match. We're really excited to see it too. We're gonna take a break, but while we're gone, guys, don't forget, get on Reddit, get on Twitter, all your social medias. Be talking about this, bring your friends in, because only one more best of three tonight, Zoya.
Yep, well guys, we're gonna go a quick commercial break, and when we get back, Cloud9 versus Gale Force Esports will be here.